In this screencast, we'll discuss the concept of the fail-safe status of valves. To do this, we will look at the example of determining if, for the following situations, whether or not the valves should fail open or fail closed. Before solving these problems, we're going to first discuss the fail-safe status of valves. So really what the fail-safe status represents is how the valve should operate when control is lost. And typically, control will be lost for a control system when there is a power outage or something similar along those lines. But a good way to think about it is if they lose the power. So if you lose power, how do you want your valve to operate? And this is dictated solely by your process. For analyzing the process, you want to make sure to think both locally at the stage of the particular unit operation, but also globally. You must remember the fact that in many situations, what's exiting a heat exchanger will eventually go into multiple unit operations after that. So therefore, when deciding if the valve should fail closed or fail open, you want to make sure of the fact that the consequences of what's happening downstream are taken into account. So as indicated earlier, we have two types of fail-safe statuses for valves. The first is fail open, which is also known as air to close. The reason why it gets this name is the fact that many valves are pneumatic and are based off of air pressure, so therefore we would need to increase the air in order to close the valve, because that is the opposite of the fail-safe status. If it fails when we have, let's say, no air, we would want the system to open, to be fully open. Therefore, we would need more air to close. Similarly, we have a fail-closed valve as the second option, also known as an air-to-open valve. So if we look at a valve here where it is fully closed and fully open, what we see is that for a fail open valve, I'm going to want my air to be at a minimum, or oftentimes in block diagrams, what comes into the valve block is a controller output. So we're going to want 0% controller output to represent when the valve is fully open, because if all power is lost, that means the controller's gone, so it will default to 0%. Similarly, for a fully closed valve, we would want 100% controller output. So therefore, the controller output increases as I close the valve more. But for a fail-closed valve, the opposite is the case, where I would want 0% controller output for a fully closed valve and 100% controller output for a fully open valve. So here, an increase in controller output opens my valve further. By convention, the gain for a fail-closed valve is positive, and the gain for a fail open valve is negative. This is solely by convention and is dictated by a majority of valves and processes fail closed. So now with the information that we have about fail open and fail closed valves, let's discuss the two parts here. So part A was the valve for cooling water in a heat exchanger. So here, if the power were to go out, potential issues could be the fact that we could have hot process fluid that is still going through, or some remnants may be left in the heat exchanger. So therefore, we would want this to fail open to allow for any remnants of the warm process fluid to be cooled, because this could potentially have ramifications if some of this remnants of this fluid are allowed to flow further downstream and potentially to areas where they may not be able to handle this stream, or could cause reactions or separations that are non-ideal. Part B, so here the concern would be the fact that if the process went under a power outage, it would mean the fact that the fluid was no longer being treated as desired. So therefore, you could be releasing fluid that is off specification and could be quite toxic for the environment. Therefore, we would want this to be fail closed to allow for treatment after whatever issue that led to the power outage or whatnot has been remediated. So in this screencast, we discussed the idea of fail open and fail closed valves and how we would go through the process of selecting them. Again, just to reiterate, an important point here is you have to make sure that you think both locally in how you make this decision and globally.